In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask you pardon for my sins and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. Come, you blessed of my Father, receive the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Alleluia. Thus sings the Church in the liturgy of today, Wednesday of the octave of Easter. And the first thing that strikes me with that entrance antiphon is the fact that the Church in the liturgy is inviting all of us. It's God inviting all of us. Come, you blessed of my Father. Receive the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. It's as if our Mother, the Church, wants to remind us, that salvation history finds its apex with the passion, death, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, which we commemorated in a very, I would always say, dramatic way during Holy Week. And so that therefore the gates of heaven have been reopened for all of us. The means of salvation are there for us. All that's necessary is that we go. That's why this needs to be repeated. Come, you blessed of my Father. Receive the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. It's like it's our birthright, lost because of original sin, but recovered for us by the passion, death, and resurrection of our Lord. Oh, my brothers and sisters, what more can God do for us? That's why the liturgy of the word today brings us back to that scene of Easter Sunday, the first Easter Sunday, when precisely our Lord had resurrected the small community of his disciples and knew about it already from first thing in the morning. Because the holy women went and saw an empty tomb. And then Peter and John went also, and they saw the empty tomb. The angel had appeared to Mary Magdalene and talked to her about it and gave specific instructions for them to go to Galilee because that was where our Lord was going to meet them. In other words, what the scriptures had foretold, what in fact had taken place right before their eyes that very week. And now it's, shall we say, fruition in the resurrection of our Lord. Should have been enough proof, enough evidence, shall we say, to constitute proof. Those two are different. Remember, evidence and proof for you with a juridic mind. Those who are lawyers out there know that very well. But all of these evidences or pieces of evidence should have constituted full proof for somebody who really wants to believe. And yet, precisely, the gospel illustrates for us what can happen. It happened to the disciples from Emmaus. It can happen to any one of us. So a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. That very day, the first day of the week, very Easter Sunday, two of Jesus' disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus. 7 miles in the gospel, it says 60 stadia. The stadium was a measure of length. And they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them, but their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. My brothers and sisters, first let's look at the literal sense. The two disciples, they came from Emmaus, must have known. They saw, they were witnesses, firsthand witnesses of what had happened during Holy Week. They had been disciples of our Lord, so they had been following him around. Before that, also listening to him, even if they were from Emmaus, and most of the time most probably had been living around Jerusalem, they were familiar with the sermons of our Lord. And yet, with the seeming debacle of Holy Week, of that Passover, especially Good Friday, the crucifixion, they got very discouraged. Not only discouraged, they panicked. Fearing that they too would be next, they were fleeing from the conflagration, so to speak, and going back to their village. Now, what strikes us now in trying to get to the literal sense is, what was their attitude, or what were they talking about? Because they were conversing and they were debating, arguing. What were they arguing about at that moment? And one can imagine that, I suppose they were ruing the fact that they thought that they had found the Messiah, and then it was a mistake after all. Perhaps they were even beginning to doubt the whole thing and blaming each other. And that's why they were debating. I told you it was like this. I knew it was like this. But then the other one would object, trying to defend what they had heard. But didn't the Messiah say that he was really going to die, and that on the third day he would rise again? And today's the third day, and some holy women there, some of our companions, had precisely said that the tomb was empty. And Peter himself and John had seen that it was empty. So there's that tug of war between what their head was saying and, on the other hand, the evidence in front of them, and what their heart of hearts wanted to believe as well. They had been won over by our Lord. They were disciples. They had wanted to believe. But then with this preponderance of contrary proof or contrary evidence, contrary factors, let's translate that, what can happen to us too. We all want to believe. We all want to love our Lord. We all want to do the good. We want to be faithful. But then there's so many contrary things. The world, the flesh, and the devil. The old enemies of the soul. First of all, the world. You see, all of these things happening, even the structures, what St. John Paul II would refer to as structures of sin, which can be a scandal for us. Remember what a scandal is? Something that you trip over. There we are, wanting to follow our Lord, but because of these difficulties, these wrong examples, the counter evidence, then we stumble. And just like the disciples of Emmaus, we may retreat to our old ways, retreat to concessions to the environment. Maybe it's not really possible to follow the Sermon on the Mount. Maybe the ideals of the Beatitudes are really too lofty and practical. Maybe we just have to go with the flow. That's one manifestation, one form of discouragement. But another thing that can happen is precisely why they were arguing. It seems like one of them was willing to be faithful. In other words, to what they had heard so far, defend what their position, what they had been doing, while the other one was already going to concessions. That's a possibility also, which we, when we apply to ourselves, is what happens when, you know, things happen that reveal to us what God really wants, or reveal to us where we need to change. Events, things that we hear, spiritual direction, a close retreat, or even just a day of recollection. And there we see in the horizon of our spiritual life, the sunrise, so to speak. The rays of light, possibilities, greater generosity, or perhaps defects that all along we have always had, but which we had refused to accept up to that moment when it becomes clearer. I tend to be self-righteous, or I'm so disorderly, or I don't know what, whatever. And still we refuse. It's pride. Remember that pride means self-affirmation. All of us, we have that tendency. And it will accompany us all the way to the grave. To affirm ourselves that we're okay, instead of looking at our Lord, who's telling us, come follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Or learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart. Oh my Lord, how patient you are with me. How patient you are with us. That after decades of following you, those poor disciples of Emmaus had been following our Lord around for barely 2 years. And we could very well understand how they can flake off at that moment. But you and I, my brothers, and those of us who are older, just celebrated my 70th birthday. Oh, what can you say? Wow, you have been following our Lord. You have been in that vocation to Opus Dei. You have been a priest for so long, and still you haven't seen this? Answer, yes. We're all capable of blindness, because pride blinds, and the devil plays on it. But our Lord is also patient. I don't know why, but I just remember just this moment, an old film with Tom Selleck as a pilot, and much younger Tom Selleck. And it was set in somewhere there in Tibet or something like that. And he had an encounter with one of those monks, those goons. And then the monk said, as if it was something so deep, oxen are slow, but the earth is patient. Oxen are slow, but the earth is patient. Well, somehow it came to my mind, that sometimes we're like ox or oxen. Ox is singular, oxen is plural, remember. We're like oxen. Slow, not slow in moving, although we can also be that, but slow in understanding, slow in accepting the truth, slow in seeing what should be very clear there. But the earth is patient. God is patient. Our Lord is patient. The Holy Spirit that's there in our soul, as long as we're in the state of grace, will keep on acting. And that's the point. We have to be in the state of grace. That's the minimum requirement of the struggle. But if we do that, then sooner or later, the light of the Holy Spirit will break through. And we see those rays, those scintilla veritatis, the sparks of the truth. What do we do then? Well, just like those disciples, we may still flee. We may still try to argue and to debate and to miss the point, getting into details instead of looking at the essential thing. What happens then? And here is the wonderful thing about this scene. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them, but their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. And he asked them, what are you discussing as you walk? They stopped, looking downcast. And one of them, named Cleophas, said to him in reply, are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know of the things that have happened, taken place there on these days or in these days? And he replied to them, what sort of things? It's a charming dialogue. those two forlorn, walking, trudging, looking down, and all of a sudden our Lord appearing there. Yeah, try to visualize the scene. They were following a road, a Roman road, most probably going to that place. If you've been to those old Roman roads, they're not very wide. They're not very small either, but there are no intersections or something like that. So if our Lord appeared, where did he appear from? He couldn't have been coming from Emmaus. He was also coming from Jerusalem. So it's as if here's this other traveler that overtook them. They were walking very slow, slowly, trudging precisely. In Tagalog, we say lulugulugo, out of discouragement, out of disappointment. Besides, they were talking to each other, they were debating, discussing, and our Lord caught up with them, this is stranger, and begins this conversation. Oh my Lord, you always catch up with us. You always come at the right moment. You make yourself accessible. In Spanish, we say encontradizo, somebody what do you call this? You meet up with. Our Lord is not scarce, doesn't make himself scarce. Our Lord doesn't hide in around corners. He's there right in front of us many times. It's we who are trudging along with our forlorn or too engrossed with their own problems, with their own issues, that we don't see him. We have to look at our Lord immediately and begin that conversation as he began them and reply to them, what sort of things? You see, when we go to prayer, our Lord pulls our tongue. There's a great advantage of going to prayer. It's not so much what we ask our Lord that's important, really. It's what he wants to give us. But many times we don't even know what to ask for. We don't even realize what the real issues are. And so he pulls our tongue. In the process of opening up, in the process of contemplating the gospel scenes, in the process of considering the words of the liturgy of the day, things come up, prop up. It's our Lord saying, what things? Then they said to him, the things that had happened to Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, how our chief priests and rulers both handed him over to a sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that he would be the one to redeem Israel. And besides all this, it's now the third day since this took place. And some women from our group, however, have astounded us. They were at the tomb early in the morning and did not find his body. They came back and reported that they indeed had seen a vision of angels who announced that he was alive. They were talking about Easter Sunday morning. They had heard about it. They hadn't understood. But now, talking about it with our Lord, it gives our Lord the occasion to explain to them the scripture, what had been said about him, how the events of Holy Week or the Passover had been a fulfillment of what had been prophesied. And that even now, with the resurrection, the plan of salvation was unfolding before their eyes, so that they had no reason to be panicking and to be arguing, to be fighting between the two of them. What they should rather do is open their minds, their eyes, their minds, their hearts to the presence of the resurrected one in front of them. You know, Emmaus is not really known where it is. The gospel says 60 stadia. It's about 7 miles or about 10 kilometers, 11 kilometers from Jerusalem. Traditionally, all throughout history, several sites had been, shall we say, proposed Diggings have been done, things have been unearthed, and so there are three candidates for this. One is a little village, exactly 60 kilometers north of Jerusalem. What's it called? I'm reading from a book here, Al-Kubaybah. Al-Kubaybah, exactly 60 stadia north of Jerusalem. It became an Arab village. It was overrun by the Muslims, but then the Christian crusaders recovered it. But anyway, that's one. It's inconsequential now, but there was a time when it was important enough that it was even an episcopal see. In other words, big enough to have a cathedral, to have its own bishop in the past. Another place, which is almost 60 stadia also, is what is now called Abu Ghosh. This is not exactly north, but northwest, the road going to Tel Aviv nowadays. And nowadays, in that place, there's a retreat house, visitor center, where they're displaced and where they're beginning some kind of courses for tour guides to the Holy Land, and a hospitality center, school for women to run that place precisely because it's a retreat house, it's a conference center. It's called Saksum. It's a project that was initiated at the behest of the first prelate of Opus Dei, first successor of Saint Josemaria, Bishop Alvaro del Portillo, who saw the lines when they were gotten but never saw them done. Later on, his successor, Bishop Javier Echeverria, saw it done, and now it's there. And activities are being done there. Well, if you ever go to the Holy Land, I strongly advise you include the trip to Saksum, because it contains very nice things that help you understand, that will help you understand the Holy Land. Well, that's there, 60 stadia from Jerusalem, but still, the objection to all of this is that they're too close to Jerusalem. 60 stadia, which is stated in the gospel, is a little bit too close, because 60 stadia, 11 kilometers, no matter how slow you walk, 11 kilometers, you'll cover in a couple of hours. And yet, it says that they arrive in Emmaus when the sun was setting. So they had been walking the whole day. So it couldn't be just 60 stadia. So their theory is that maybe instead of 60, it was 160, in the transcription, in the writing, or whatever. Now, true enough, farther north, 160 stadia from Jerusalem, northwest, that is, going towards Tel Aviv, is another place which is the most popular place for Emmaus nowadays, which is Emmaus Nicopolis. By the way, all three places are called Emmaus. That's the reason for the confusion. And there's also a big church, several churches, all through the centuries. And that's what, if 60 stadia is 10 kilometers, so 160 stadia is more than that, 24 kilometers, 25 kilometers. And that's just about right for what the gospel says. But commenting on this confusion of places, Pope Benedict the 16th referred to the fact that the Emmaus spoken of in the gospel has not yet been definitely identified. And he says there are various hypotheses, and this in itself is suggestive because it means We can think that Emmaus really represents everywhere. The road to Emmaus is the road of every Christian, even of every man and woman. The risen Jesus becomes our traveling companion to rekindle the fire of faith and hope in our hearts and to break the bread of eternal life. In other words, it's not the place that's important here. What's important is the journey to Emmaus. What happened during that trip? And what happened in Emmaus itself at the end of that trip is not the place itself, but the journey and the destination. And that's why some people have called it, and I like to use the terminology also, of the so-called Emmaus experience or the Emmaus event. That all of us, one way or another, would have our Emmaus as well. Quite different from the Damascus experience, like the conversion of St. Paul, or the experience of St. Peter in the Appian Way, that great conversion of a moment. But the process of our Lord accompanying us towards a conversion, that's what Emmaus represents. Commenting on this passage, there are several considerations made by Saint Jose Maria, founder of Opus Dei, that can help us when he says, there were two disciples on their way to Emmaus, and they were walking along at a normal pace, like so many other travelers on that road. And there, without any fuss, Jesus appeared to them and walks with them, his conversation helping to alleviate their tiredness. I can well imagine the scene. Just as dusk was falling, a gentle breeze was blowing, and all around were fields ripe with wheat and venerable olive trees, their branches shimmering in the soft glowing light. Our Lord's presence must have inspired them with great trust, because with just a couple of sentences, they were already pouring out their hearts. He had them pouring out their hearts to him. And then St. Jose Maria continues, Christ understands their sorrow. He sees into their heart and communicates to them some of the life he carries within himself. Their hopes that Jesus would set Israel free had ended at the crucifixion. When they left Jerusalem, they knew that his body was no longer in the tomb, and that the women said that they had been told of his resurrection by angels, but they did not believe it. They were sad, and their faith was wavering. Then Jesus said to them, O foolish men, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken, was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. That's the gospel. And now the commentary. What a conversion that must have been, and St. Jose Maria says. The journey ends when they reach the village. The two disciples, who without realizing it, have been deeply stirred by the words and love shown by God made man, are sorry to see him leaving, for Jesus made as if he was going further. However, the two disciples stopped him and practically forced him to stay with them. They begged him, stay with us, for it's towards evening and the day is now far spent. Let's pause there and consider once more what had happened during that journey. Our Lord explained to them the scripture. Their minds were opened at last. So then they understood. That was the beginning of the conversion, another conversion, a recognition of the light, a recognition of the revelation for us, and whatever light that is that we had considered a few minutes ago. And then I would even comment, were not our hearts burning within us when he walked, when he explained the scripture and talked to us along the way? They felt their hearts burning. And so taken were they by this revelation, so convinced were they of this stranger, erstwhile stranger, that when they arrived in Emmaus finally, toward the end of the day, and Jesus appeared as if he were going on, they stopped him. Manen iscum, Domine, stay with us, Lord. They wanted to prolong the discussion, the explanation, the dialogue of the way. My brothers and sisters, this is what prayer is. That's what we try to do with the 30 minutes of dialogue with our Lord in the tabernacle in the morning, another 30 minutes in the afternoon. This is what we actually doing, each one of the norms of the plan of life. Because it's our Lord telling us this time. Mane, manete mecum, stay with me. We don't have to ask our Lord, Mane nobiscum, stay with us, because he has stayed. That's what the tabernaculum is. Remember, we had considered this many times in the past. The word tabernaculum in Latin means tent, and in the original Hebrew sense of the word tent, the Shekinah, is not just the physicality of the tent. Is the remaining, the abiding, is the abode. God has stayed with us. And it's He now is telling us, Manete mecum, stay with me, all of you. Come to me, your burden, I will give you rest. Learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart. Stay with me, stay with me. And if we do, then what happens is what happened next. That we read also in this episode, as narrated by the evangelist. And it happened that while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. They began to recognize him while they were talking, but they really recognized him in the breaking of the bread. Now, let's again pause a bit. What happened there? Why did they recognize him in the breaking of the bread? Remember, this was Easter day. The breaking of the bread, meaning to say the Last Supper, when our Lord instituted the Holy Eucharist, and together with that, therefore, instituted the sacrament of sacred order, so that the breaking of the bread may be done until the end of time, may be represented, made present until the end of time, happened just a couple of nights ago. Well, Thursday evening, then you have Friday evening, Saturday evening, so 3 nights before that. When the disciples were scattered, and so the likelihood that this was referred to their familiarity with what happened during Easter evening, the Passover meal that our Lord had with his disciples, is quite remote. They hadn't had a chance to refer with the apostles. Maybe they did. We don't know. But then what was more likely was they recognized our Lord simply by the way he broke the bread, the way he ate, the conversation that they had at table. Because they had done that in the past. They were disciples. There had been the multiplication of the bread and fishes, most probably. There had been at other gatherings with our Lord. They were disciples, not one of the 12, but maybe some of the 72 even that were sent by our Lord in pairs in order to evangelize. But wherever it was, they recognized our Lord in the breaking of the bread. And when we apply that to us, that's the Holy Eucharist, definitely. That's the Mass. And by extension, all the other sacraments, which are the visible signs instituted by Christ in his church in order to transmit grace. We should end. Time has passed. But the formula for the interior life, the bread and the word first, prayer, reading of scripture, study, and in the bread, foremost of which is the Mass, the Holy Eucharist, Holy Communion, but all the other sacraments as well. These are the means of salvation. These are the means of encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. And if we're going to make that happen, then perhaps each one of us, we need to have our own Emmaus experience. The word, prayer. Break into light. Don't allow pride, prejudice, whatever other factors that may be there to put a cloud between that light that's breaking out, which is the fruit of the passion and death of our Lord. Is the light of Pentecost. Is the voice of the Paraclete working in our soul. Don't allow that to be muted by our own pride, by our own prejudices, or by the structures of sin around us. Recognize all of those things for what they are. Estorbo. And let's go straight to our Lord. And what happened in Emmaus could very well happen to us as well. Yes, there's a reason why there's an octave of Easter. There's a reason why there's a whole Easter season that lasts all the way to Pentecost. Because we have to reap the fruits of Holy Week. Holy Week, can it be something that passed by so quickly, agitated even, because of all the movements? Even if we had gone on a pilgrimage, then all those movements are agitations. We have to let things settle down now. And that's what the Easter season is for. The Halcyon days of Easter, I normally refer to them. Let's allow these things to sink in. Let's savor them. As we were considering last Easter Sunday, those words of St. Paul, quesusum sunt querite, quesusum sunt sapite. Seek the things that are from above. Savor, acquire a taste for the things from above. And this is what Easter is for. And that's our inheritance. That's what Christ has won for us. And our Blessed Mother, just like what happened with the apostles, with the disciples of our Lord in that early Christian community, will be there with us in our midst, gathering us together with her maternal presence, so that like that prayer and breaking the bread, celebrating the Eucharist, we will be there faithfully to receive the fullness of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost. Spend a few minutes concretizing your resolutions as usual.